Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Evolution, The Remarkable History of a Scientific Theory by Edward J. Larson, narrated by John McDonough and directed by Chris Talsness. This book is copyrighted 2004 by Edward J. Larson. This recording is copyrighted 2004 by Recorded Books. I often said before starting that I had no doubt I should frequently repent of the whole undertaking. So wrote Charles Darwin aboard the Beagle, bound for the Galapagos Islands and what would arguably become the greatest and most controversial achievement in scientific history. But the theory of evolution did not spring full-blown from the head of Darwin. Since the dawn of humanity, priests, philosophers, and scientists have debated the origin and development of life on Earth, and with modern science, that debate has shifted into high gear. And now, Evolution.
Chapter 1. Bursting the Limits of Time. Georges Cuvier had a large head, a famously large head, and an ego more than sufficient to swell even it. From his position atop the French scientific establishment during the first third of the 19th century, he accumulated high academic posts and official honors like some favored children collect toys, never enough and all kept in play. For his contributions to laying the foundations of modern biology, Cuvier willingly suffered comparisons to Aristotle, the acknowledged founder of the science. As a naturalist, Cuvier fancied himself the French Newton, bringing order to the life sciences, much as Isaac Newton brought order to the physical sciences. Cuvier's rigorous empirical methods opened windows into the Earth's biological history that would lead others to a vision of organic evolution he steadfastly refused to see. More than any other naturalist, he so greatly influenced the style and substance of 19th century biology that the history of the modern scientific theory of evolution rightly begins with him, its staunchest foe. Born in 1769 into an educated bourgeois family in the Protestant, French-speaking portion of the independent French-German duchy of Württemberg, Cuvier was trained at a regional academy to serve in the Duke's government. Pushed by his mother to excel academically, Cuvier's formal education included a solid introduction to natural history, a traditional subject encompassing such modern fields as biology, geology, oceanography, mineralogy, and paleontology. This subject became his passion. In 1788, with no government position open to him at home, Cuvier accepted employment as a private tutor for a French noble family in Normandy. There, as a sideline, he immersed himself in the study of marine invertebrates. From the relative safety of rural Normandy, Cuvier witnessed the French Revolution that began, from his perspective, with high hopes in 1789, but turned terribly ugly during the early 1790s. Becoming a citizen of France in 1793, when the French government annexed his homeland, Cuvier accepted a post in the revolutionary administration of Normandy, even as he turned viscerally against the central regime's terror and focused his own attentions on zoological fieldwork. In 1795, when a moderate republican government took power in Paris and promised to rebuild the central scientific establishment decapitated during the terror, Cuvier moved to the capital in search of a career in science. There were plenty of openings for a naturalist of his obvious brilliance and driving ambition. Cuvier gained an assistantship at the renowned Museum of Natural History and never looked back. His subsequent rise was meteoric. The study of natural history would never be the same. Cuvier concentrated his scientific research on the burgeoning field of comparative anatomy. He was convinced that the internal structure of an animal revealed its function and therefore its true nature. In biology, as in all else, form followed function for Cuvier. His research profited greatly from his position at the world's premier natural history museum, an institution that rapidly became ever more comprehensive in its zoological holdings as Napoleon's armies plundered the collections of Europe and sent home live, preserved, and fossilized specimens from as far afield as Russia and Egypt. Ultimately, Cuvier proposed that there are four, but only four, basic anatomical types. He called them embranchements of animals. Vertebrates with backbones, mollusks with shells, articulates such as insects, and radiates such as starfish. Lesser divisions, he wrote, are only modifications superficially founded on development or on the addition of certain parts, but which in no way change the essence of the plan. This view, built solidly on anatomical analysis and still reflected with modifications in modern taxonomy, shattered the hierarchical concept dating from Aristotle of a single great chain of beings rising in fine gradations from the simplest living form to humans at its top. The idea within biology of seeing an anthropomorphic order in all living things gave way to studying them on their own terms. Cuvier was the first naturalist to have at his disposal a suitably complete collection of the world's mammals, past and present, to make definitive distinctions among them. He made the most of this advantage, hoarding it to himself, his collaborators, and his protégés. In 1796, for example, he announced that, based on his anatomical comparisons of actual specimens, the elephants of India and Africa constituted two distinct species, and that both of them differed from the elephant-like mammoth found only in fossil remains. The positive identification of other living and extinct mammals followed one after another in rapid succession. To account for so many extinct species, as early as 1796, Cuvier announced the existence of a world previous to ours, destroyed by some kind of catastrophe. Before Cuvier, European naturalists typically held that no species, all of them perfect in their original creation, ever died out. Fossils had no fundamental significance. Such things were simply sports of nature or remnants of some still-living species. Overturning this view, Cuvier ultimately concluded that all fossilized animals differed in kind from modern ones, and that no modern species existed in truly fossil form. He boldly claimed the power to burst the limits of time, and by some observations of fossils, to recover the history of the world, and the succession of events that preceded the birth of the human species. Suddenly, life had a history different from the present, and fossil fragments revealed it. As a new species of antiquarian, Cuvier explained, I have had to reconstruct the ancient beings to which these fragments belonged, to reproduce them in their proportions and characters, and finally to compare them to those that live today. The modern science of paleontology was born in Cuvier's laboratory. Because of his conviction that the form of any animal precisely served its functional needs, Cuvier confidently assumed that trained researchers could, in principle, reconstruct its entire structure from any one of its functional parts. Paleontologists could do for extinct animals what comparative anatomists did for living ones. Definitively identify them. Doing so for all of the Earth's past and present species became Cuvier's goal for science, and he himself would launch the effort, doing his own best work with fishes and four-footed mammals. A compulsive worker, stern and impatient, Cuvier never doubted his own ability as a science researcher, educator, and administrator. He mastered the treacherous shoals of French academic politics just as ably as he mastered comparative anatomy. Even as he climbed the professional ladder within the Museum of Natural History, Cuvier gained leadership posts at the National Institute and the University of France, giving him unparalleled influence over patronage within the country's highly centralized science establishment. Napoleon named Cuvier to the Council of State in 1813, and he deftly kept his seat and steadily expanded his portfolio under three succeeding monarchs. Remarkably, even though every ruler he served was forcibly driven from office at least once, Cuvier held each of his official posts for life and died peacefully in his bed in 1832. Napoleon ennobled him as a chevalier. Louis XVIII promoted him to the rank of baron. Under Charles X, he became a grand officer of the Legion of Honor. Louis-Philippe made him a peer of France. Cuvier was short and during the Revolution was thin, one biographer Riley noted. He became stouter during the Empire, and he grew enormously fat after the Restoration. Still, there was that massive head, crowned by a thick mane of hair. According to one observer, Cuvier's head gave to his entire person an undeniable cachet of majesty, and to his face an expression of profound meditation. Here was the lion of 19th-century French science and founder of modern comparative anatomy and paleontology. Yet his reasoned scientific arguments for the theory of special creation held back the tide of evolutionary thought, which had been rising since the Enlightenment for a generation. On the matter of organic evolution, or the transmutation of species, as the concept was then called, it was not simply that Cuvier died before the publication of Charles Darwin's Origin of Species, and therefore never seriously considered the idea. He studied it carefully, albeit not in the light of Darwin's later arguments for it, and found it wanting. Although Cuvier's conclusions on this score reflected his religious and social beliefs, they were founded on his scientific understanding of nature. These added factors, religious and social, reveal telling aspects of pre-Darwinian Western thought about biological origins. They will be examined first. Living in a particularly volatile era of French religious history, characterized by alternating phases of Enlightenment skepticism, revolutionary atheism, and Restoration Catholicism, Cuvier stood apart from most others within the cultural elite of France by remaining a church-going Protestant during his entire life. Indeed, he visibly aligned himself with his religious minority by overseeing government programs for Protestant education and serving as vice president of the Protestant Bible Society of Paris. He married a socially prominent Roman Catholic widow of the Terror, Anne-Marie Coquette du Trezail, but they raised four children as Protestants. When his daughter Clémentine adopted an evangelical form of Protestantism, however, she grew to doubt her father's salvation and prayed for his conversion. That was not about to happen, at least on her terms. By definition, evangelicals publicly proclaim their religious beliefs and seek to convert others. But for Georges Cuvier, religion was a strictly private matter. Perhaps it had to be so for him to prosper in French science and politics, but that lends an unjustifiably cynical slant to Cuvier's case. Although he was the very embodiment of reason and science, Cuvier accepted religious truth as existing wholly apart from reason. This made his private religious beliefs virtually invisible to others. Despite considerable speculation, they have remained so to this day. Yet surely he was a Bible-believing Christian of some sort, and biblical Christianity carries with it certain presuppositions about origins. These presuppositions informed Cuvier's thinking about evolution, just as they would for so many other Christians. The biblical account of creation appears in the book of Genesis, which is sacred scripture for Jews, Christians, and Muslims. For the Orthodox, Genesis represents the revealed Word of God, and as such carries special meaning in some literal, allegorical, or mystical sense. Even for liberal theists, led during the 19th century by a growing number of German and French theologians whose work Cuvier read, the Genesis account carries meaning as an early record of the Jewish people's understanding of God's role in creation. Indeed, For those like Cuvier, who accepted Moses as its author, Genesis gains authority as one of the earliest written records of creation. Accorded any of these meanings, the Genesis account becomes foundational for one's understanding of nature. The first chapter of Genesis tells of God creating the heavens and the earth, then plants and animals, and finally humans, everything in 6 days. All types of plants and animals are said to reproduce according to their kind. Read literally, this precludes evolution from one kind of plant or animal to another. Regarding humans, the account declares that God separately created them in his own image and likeness. The second chapter of Genesis contains an alternative creation account, in which the order of the appearance of life forms on earth is somewhat reversed, but with a similar emphasis on the special creation of humans by God. Indeed, it is this second account that first introduces Adam and Eve as the progenitors of the human race, with God directly forming them as man and woman. The Bible does not state when these creation events occurred, but most early Christians probably assumed they all happened within the past 6,000 years. During the mid-1600s, Anglican Archbishop James Usher of Dublin used internal evidence within the Bible to calculate the year of creation as 4004 BC, or less than 3,000 years before Genesis was supposedly written by the Hebrew leader Moses. Printed in the margins of the Authorized or King James Version of the Bible, Usher's chronology became quasi-gospel for British and American Protestants during the 18th and 19th centuries. Generally speaking, Christian leaders from the early church through the Reformation did not view the Bible as a scientific text. They interpreted it as a divinely authored or inspired volume of separately written books and letters filled with spiritual meanings, some of them allegorical. Science, in the sense of a distinct intellectual tradition seeking rational explanations for physical phenomena, began with ancient Greek natural philosophy roughly 500 years before Christ. Although most individual Greeks probably accepted religious or mythical explanations for natural phenomena, some Greek philosophers sought to separate the supernatural from the natural by proposing purely materialistic accounts of nature. Nothing is aught but physical matter in meaningless motion, the ancient Greek atomists proclaimed. The origin of life and individual species posed a particular problem for Greeks intent on devising purely materialistic explanations for natural phenomena. Creation implies a creator, and so, to dispense with the need for a biological creator, such ancient philosophers as Anaximander, Empedocles, the atomists, and the Epicureans advanced various crude notions of organic evolution. Based on his close study of animal anatomy, however, Aristotle concluded that species are absolutely immutable. Each species always breeds true to its form, he maintained, and never gives birth to a new type. Rejecting both creation and evolution, Aristotle, an atheist, simply posited that species are eternal. Integrating the Genesis account with mainstream Aristotelian science, pre-modern Christian naturalists viewed species as created by God in the beginning and thereafter fixed for all time in a perfect, albeit fallen, creation. Well into the 19th century, even Cuvier saw no scientific reason to reject Aristotelian thinking on the fixity of species, and fully appreciated the religious advantages of retaining it. Whether read literally or allegorically, the Genesis account harmonizes with the idea that species, once created, never change. By 1800, Cuvier also had compelling social reasons for maintaining the traditional Aristotelian view of species. The breakdown of established authority associated with the Enlightenment in 18th century France coincided with a revival of pre-Christian speculation about organic evolution and biological reductionism or materialism. At its core, the Enlightenment, the intellectual launching pad of modernity, involved a rational critique of previously accepted doctrines and institutions. To the extent that Christianity was based on divine revelation rather than human reason, it lost credibility among enlightened thinkers. Similarly, to the extent that they lacked rational justification, political and cultural institutions trembled or fell, including the Ancien Régime. During the 1790s in France, King Louis XVI lost his head and the Roman Catholic Church was outlawed. Revolutionary currents swirled through natural history as well. Some radical naturalists and savants challenged static concepts in science, including the fixity of species. Many of them rejected any ongoing role for the supernatural in the natural. Rational materialism gained ground in scientific, social, and political thought, with no clear separation among these disciplines. Disorder became the order of the day, and a reaction became inevitable. Among 18th-century French scientists, Georges-Louis Leclerc, Comte de Buffon, personified the Enlightenment. One of the foremost descriptive naturalists of his day, Buffon was also a highly original theorist who, as superintendent from 1739 to 1788 of the Royal Garden, which became the Museum of Natural History after the Revolution, commanded the position and prestige to promote his novel ideas about nature. In all these respects, academic field, official status, and scientific renown, Buffon was Cuvier's predecessor, but never his precursor. Although historians still debate whether Buffon was an outright atheist or simply a radical deist, he certainly rejected Christianity and sought materialistic explanations for the origin of the earth and its inhabitants. This led him to evolutionary thought. Scientific materialism ran through Buffon's massive treatise, Natural History, which appeared in 15 initial and 7 supplemental volumes over the 40-year period from 1749 to 1789. The Earth and other planets congealed from globs of molten matter thrown off when a comet crashed into the sun, Buffon proposed in Volume 1, and living things spontaneously generated on the Earth as it cooled, he added in later volumes. For proof, he offered crude experiments with molten iron balls, whose cooled surfaces conveniently wrinkled like the Earth's terrestrial surface, and boiled meat gravy, which became alive with microorganisms when cooled. By volume 14 of his treatise, Buffon was speculating about the evolutionary origins of similar species from common ancestral types, perhaps as few as 38 original forms, for the 200-odd mammalian species known at the time, he estimated. For example, he proposed that all the world's various lions, tigers, leopards, pumas, and domestic cats degenerated in response to local climatic conditions from a single ancestral type of cat. This constitutes evolution, at least on a limited scale. As evidence, Buffon offered the observation that Native American mammals, be they cats, bears, or people, were invariably smaller and weaker than their Old World counterparts. Surely the American types had degenerated due to the New World's harsh climate. Such thinking pushed God as creator either back in time or out of the picture altogether. Buffon never made it clear which. It also enraged Thomas Jefferson, who countered with depictions of large, strong Native American animals in his 1787 book, Notes on the State of Virginia. Buffon placed limits on his materialism by postulating that certain internal molds guide the spontaneous generation and subsequent degeneration of living organisms. Due to these molds, each basic biological family remains distinct through time, he asserted. One type of cat might degenerate into another type of cat, but never into a dog. Buffon did not say who or what designed these internal molds, but their ongoing existence retained a foundational element of design in nature. Thus, unlike under some later theories of evolution, neither the original generation of nor subsequent variations in living things was utterly random. In fact, in the second supplemental volume of his Natural History, Buffon asserted that under similar climatic conditions, fundamentally similar species would spontaneously generate on any planet. For him, internal molds were universal and eternal. Nothing less could explain the apparent orderliness of life. Anything more might leave too much room for God. Any metaphysics was too much for the extreme materialists of the French Enlightenment. The radical mid-18th century encyclopedist Denis Diderot saw no trace of design in nature, for example. Any form of living thing could spontaneously generate itself in a purely material process, he argued. Those forms that could survive and reproduce would do so while all others would die out, leaving the current diversity of life on Earth without any divine intervention along the way. Although Diderot envisioned a purely random process spawning and modifying life on Earth, much as orthodox Darwinists later maintained, he, unlike them, attributed a primitive awareness to the matter that self-generated into living beings. Paul-Henri Thierry, Baron d'Holbach, dispensed with even this bit of retained vitalism. In his 1770 System of Nature, widely known as the Bible of Atheism, Holbach simply asserted that inert matter could self-organize into complex structures. When they became complex enough, these material structures would exhibit the properties of life. Though Diderot and Holbach drew on the work of various naturalists, including Buffon, to support their philosophical speculations, neither conducted original scientific research. As prophets of atheism and champions of the radical left, they mainly sought to account for the origin of life without recourse to design or a designer, and paid scant attention to technical points of how species are formed. As a consequence, their writings had greater philosophical than scientific impact. Some Enlightenment naturalists found evidence of materialism at the foundation of life, however. In 1740, Swiss naturalist Abraham Tremblay discovered the polyp, or freshwater hydra, a peculiar little animal that could regenerate multiple complete beings when cut into parts. A fellow Swiss naturalist, Charles Bonnet, soon found that some species of worms could do the same. Meanwhile, the Swiss physician Albrecht von Haller demonstrated that certain animal tissues, including human muscles, reacted directly to electrical shock without any intervention of the brain or a soul. Inspired by these observations, French naturalist Julien Auffroy de la Mettrie described life as a basic principle of organic matter itself, and not as the product of an independent mind or indwelling soul. Such thinking reached into popular culture. Drawing on scientific speculation about subtle electrical and magnetic fluids animating life, for example, during the years leading up to the French Revolution, German physician Franz Mesmer established a highly lucrative practice treating the muscle cramps and headaches of wealthy Parisians, including Queen Marie Antoinette, with magnetic cures featuring an early form of hypnosis that became known as mesmerism. Of course, no one can precisely gauge how much Enlightenment thinking about material origins for life and organic species contributed to the political, social, and religious turmoil of the French Revolution, but some observers at the time saw a causal link. Notions of biological instability seemed to breed social disorder. Rational materialism undermined traditional political and religious authority, and chaos ensued as the law of the jungle became the rule in Paris. For Cuvier, who was traumatized by the revolution and thereafter sought political and social order above all, this connection damned the very idea of organic evolution and all manners of biological speculation. Empirical facts alone could provide a solid basis for science and society, he believed, Speculative systems in natural history invited ruin. Persuaded as I am of the futility of all these systems, I find myself pleased each time a well-established fact comes and destroys one of them, Cuvier proclaimed in 1804. He reported to Napoleon 4 years later, "Our natural sciences are only the facts brought together, our theories only formulae which embrace a great number of them." Cuvier took every opportunity to criticize the speculations of Buffon and other materialist-minded naturalists. In his 1796 inaugural lecture at the National Institute, he made a point of attacking Buffon's theory of evolutionary degeneration, even though Buffon was long dead and his theory had not attracted many followers. Pointing to functional anatomical differences between Indian and African elephants, Cuvier declared, "Whatever may be the influence of climate to make animals vary, it surely does not extend this far. To say that it can change all the proportions of the bony framework and the intimate texture of the teeth would be to claim that all quadrupeds could have been derived from a single species, that the differences they show are only successive degenerations. In a word, it would be to reduce the whole of natural history to nothing, for its objects would consist only of variable forms and fleeting types." From this initial outburst to his final public debates with the evolutionary naturalist Étienne Geoffroy Saint-Hilaire in 1830, Cuvier opposed the idea of organic evolution in all its forms. At the time, he was not alone in seeing a radical tint to the so-called transmutation hypothesis. However much his religious and social views may have biased him, Cuvier had solid scientific reasons for rejecting the concept of organic evolution. Those reasons were not reactionary. Quite to the contrary, they reflected the most progressive science of the day, science that, in Cuvier's own words, burst the traditional limits of geologic time. His findings in both primary fields of his scientific research, comparative anatomy and paleontology, convinced Cuvier that evolution was impossible. Working under Buffon, Louis-Jean-Marie Dombonton pioneered the study of comparative anatomy at the Old Royal Garden in Paris, focusing his work on the external characteristics and major organs of animals. Shifting his research to mineralogy after the garden's post-revolution reorganization into the Museum of Natural History, Dombonton supported the appointment of Cuvier to assist with anatomical studies. Building on the work of Dombonton's former assistant, Félix Vic d'Azyr, who died during the revolution, Cuvier stressed the importance of examining an animal's entire internal structure down to its smallest parts. Close analysis of mammals gave Cuvier an unprecedented appreciation of what he came to see as the irreducible functional complexity of living things. Today, comparative anatomy has reached such a point of perfection that, after inspecting a single bone, one can often determine the class, and sometimes even the genus, of the animal to which it belongs, Cuvier commented in 1798. This is because the number, direction, and shape of the bones that compose each part of an animal's body are always in a necessary relation to all the other parts, in such a way that, up to a point, one can infer the whole from any one of them. Here he added a telling example. If an animal's teeth are such as they must be in order for it to nourish itself with flesh, we can be sure without further examination that the whole system of its digestive organs is appropriate for that kind of food, and that its whole skeleton and locomotive organs, and even its sense organs, are arranged in such a way as to make it skillful at pursuing and catching its prey. From his study of animal structure, Cuvier devised his doctrine of the correlation of parts. Every organized being forms a whole, a unique and closed system, in which all the parts correspond mutually and contribute to the same definitive action by a reciprocal reaction. He wrote in the widely read preliminary discourse to his landmark 1812 Recherche sur les ossements fossiles. None of its parts can change without the others changing too, and consequently each of them, taken separately, indicates and gives all the others. Taken seriously, and Cuvier took everything he wrote with the utmost seriousness, this doctrine precludes organic evolution. No materialistic evolutionist ever claimed that all an animal's parts changed simultaneously. That would be as grand a miracle as divine creation. For evolution to occur, the process must involve an accumulation of changes. Yet Cuvier concluded, based on his research, that anatomical interactions within an animal are so delicately balanced that any meaningful change in one would render the whole being incapable of survival. Add to this doctrine a basic appreciation of the complex interdependence among species, and the common observation that individuals of a species appear to breed true to type, all of which Cuvier did, and the conclusion becomes inevitable. New species cannot evolve from old ones. In the wake of Buffon, some radical French naturalists continued to debate the merits of transmutation, despite Cuvier's doctrine of the correlation of parts, but the weight of its authority strongly reinforced the creationist position. To his anatomical arguments against evolution, Cuvier added paleontological ones. At the time, no one knew the fossil record better than Cuvier. His museum housed the finest collection of fossils in the world, and his collaboration with Alexandre Brongniart in fieldwork around Paris laid bare successive layers of geologic strata, each with its distinctive fossil types. Before Cuvier, few people found many fossils anywhere. He found them everywhere and gave them new meaning. Whether one digs into the plains, or penetrates into caves in the mountains, or climbs their torn flanks, one encounters everywhere the remains of organisms, he noted in 1800. Immense masses of shells are found at great distances from any sea, and seams of coal display the imprints of plants at heights or depths that are equally striking. But what is still more surprising is the disorder that reigns in the accumulations of these objects. Here, shelly beds are covered by others that contain only plants. There, fish are superposed to terrestrial animals, and in turn have plants or shells above them. This was and is the geologic column, and Cuvier exhumed it more fully than anyone before him. Layer upon layer of sedimentary rock, with each layer containing its own characteristic mix of fossil species, like a wedding cake whose every tier is a different flavor. Almost everywhere, Cuvier added, as if to comment on the cake's misfit icing, these remains of organisms are utterly foreign to the climate of the ground that conceals them. For Cuvier, the geologic column suggested a historical pattern of catastrophic floods, some global, others local, alternating with periods of terrestrial uplift. These were massive deluges, he surmised, such as the world has not seen at least since the biblical time of Noah. Each of these floods drowned all terrestrial life within its reach, scoured the terrain, and laid down a layer of sedimentary rock containing the fossil remains of the former population. When the land resurfaced in a later geologic epoch, different kinds of plants and animals repopulated it, perhaps through migration from other regions, perhaps by their divine creation. Cuvier's writings suggested both these options, but never committed him to either. The scientific evidence is inconclusive as to when the various species originated, Cuvier opined, so he would leave the matter to speculation rather than science. At the most, he wrote, one is authorized to believe that there has been a certain succession in the forms of living beings. Although Cuvier did not know when individual species originated, he was certain that some of them had become extinct, which was news enough in 1800. This discovery came from establishing beyond a reasonable doubt that fossilized animals found in the older layers of the geologic column differ in kind from living ones. It is the generality of this difference that makes it the most remarkable and astonishing result that I have obtained from my research, Cuvier proclaimed at the dawn of the new century. I can now almost assert that none of the truly fossil quadrupeds that I have been able to compare precisely has been found to be similar to any of those alive today. As his investigations progressed, Cuvier further generalized this assertion to cover various types of animals from different geologic epochs. For example, he later reported that the types of marine mollusks found in any particular layer of the geologic column appeared only in that layer, never in earlier or later ones. The geologic column did reveal a progression of forms from the most simple ones toward the bottom to more complex ones toward the top, Cuvier observed. The types of animals also became increasingly like present-day ones over time. For example, he noted that marine mollusks from recent fossil beds are more like living mollusks than those found in ancient beds. To some, such evidence suggested evolution. But Cuvier had already rejected this explanation based on his study of comparative anatomy, and the apparent absence of transitional forms in the fossil record confirmed this conclusion. Certainly he saw a succession of comparable types over time, but to his eye the series progressed by jumps rather than gradations. Indeed, in all his extensive study of fossils, Cuvier perceived only distinct species that persisted without change, never a gradual blurring of one type into another. Of course, his doctrine of the correlation of parts held that such change was impossible anyway. The history of current species provided further evidence for Cuvier's anti-evolutionism. The animals depicted in ancient drawings and the mummified ibises in Egyptian tombs appear identical to their living descendants, he noted. I am well aware that there I am citing monuments of only 2,000 or 3,000 years ago, Cuvier conceded, but that is as far back as it is possible to reach. It should stand for something. For Cuvier, every known scientific fact pointed toward the fixity of species. Despite his conservatism, Cuvier was a visionary figure in paleontology. There is, he declared, a series of epochs anterior to the present one, the order of which can be verified without uncertainty, although the duration of the intervals between them cannot be defined with precision. Cuvier's Earth was very old, far older than Genesis suggested. He saw evidence of a vast period extending before the appearance of any living organisms, followed by multiple geologic epochs, each populated with its own distinctive flora and fauna. Relics of all current species, including humans, appear only in the most recent geologic deposits, he asserted, and never among truly fossilized types. Thus, life on Earth has often been disturbed by terrible events, Cuvier concluded. Living organisms without number have been the victims of these catastrophes. Some were destroyed by deluges, others were left dry when the seabed was suddenly raised. Their races are even finished forever, and all they leave in the world is some debris that is hardly recognizable to the naturalist. Cuvier developed his theories of catastrophes and migration from the ideas of earlier naturalists, but, as his biographer William Coleman notes, one feature of Cuvier's geologic doctrine stood out as breathtakingly novel: the demonstration by comparative anatomy of the fact of organic succession. Cuvier's protests notwithstanding, this demonstration proved foundational for modern evolutionary thought. In his basic conception of natural history, Cuvier carried mainstream scientific opinion with him. In fact, his rhetorical invocation of fact facts, and repudiation of theorizing particularly appealed to conventional conservative naturalists, precisely those scientists most likely to accept traditional viewpoints, including biblical ones. After a generation of battering by radical French materialists, some Christian intellectuals, particularly in Britain and the United States, welcomed the findings of a prominent French naturalist whose views were not openly hostile to their own. They met him at least halfway. In 1813, a year after the French publication of Cuvier's popular Preliminary Discourse, the pious Scottish geologist Robert Jameson translated it into English under the title Essay on the Theory of the Earth, with a preface and notes stressing points where the French naturalist's views coincided with Christian doctrine. Working in the shadow of French rationalism, Cuvier never invoked scriptural authority to support his scientific arguments. But his Preliminary Discourse did observe that the date traditionally ascribed to the biblical deluge that supposedly drowned all life outside Noah's Ark roughly coincided with geologic evidence for the time of the last catastrophic flood. Jameson's annotations trumpeted this observation and Cuvier's devastating critique of evolution. During the first half of the 19th century, other conservative Christian geologists in Britain and America labored to reconcile the new scientific orthodoxy with the Genesis account. In 1814, Scottish natural theologian Thomas Chalmers proposed that a gap existed in the Genesis narrative between the book's first and second verses. This opened unlimited time for geologic epochs between the beginning and God's creation of current species. Amherst College geologist Edward Hitchcock adopted this so-called gap theory and popularized it in the United States. Meanwhile, Scottish geologist Hugh Miller suggested that the days of creation in Genesis symbolized geologic epochs. Yale University geologists Benjamin Silliman and James Dwight Dana, a father-in-law, son-in-law team, championed the day-age theory in the United States. During the mid-19th century, Cuvier's followers modified his basic outline of geologic history to keep abreast of the latest scientific findings. For example, to avoid choosing between a single creation of all life and multiple creations following the various catastrophes, Cuvier maintained that migration could account for the abrupt appearance of new species in the local fossil record of a particular place. As wider fieldwork gradually eliminated plausible sources for the migrating species, however, many of Cuvier's followers turned to multiple creations as the most realistic explanation for the abrupt appearances of species in the fossil record under a creationist model. Cuvier's equation of the biblical flood with the final catastrophe lost its principal proponents in the 1830s when British geologists Adam Sedgwick and William Buckland, both conservative Christians, concluded that a single deluge of the type described in Genesis could not produce the complex deposits attributed to the last catastrophe. For them, the biblical flood lost all geologic significance. By that time, Cuvier's Swiss disciple Louis Agassiz had shown that ice ages, rather than floods, probably caused the catastrophic extinctions recorded in the fossil record. With such modifications, Cuvier's creationism remained the dominant scientific explanation for the origin of species until the 1860s, when it vied with Darwin's theory of evolution for acceptance by mainstream scientists. Cuvier's legendary large head generated a telling anecdote. It seems that he often left his hat in his outer office. Some visiting scientists waiting to meet the great man could not resist the temptation to don it. The hat inevitably slipped over their ears and covered their eyes. Cuvier's scientific thought had somewhat the same effect on natural history. Broad and all-encompassing, it blocked alternative theories from sight, at least until a scientist of Darwin's stature lifted the brim. Chapter 2. A Growing Sense of Progress. Cuvier may have given meaning to biologic history, but dinosaurs made it come to life. The recognition that a succession of species populated the Earth was Cuvier's principal contribution to paleontology. He never envisioned the process as progressive, however, nor conceded the introduction of new species over time. Given the geographically limited range of his evidence, Cuvier could maintain, with decreasing credibility, that the fish-to-reptile-to-mammal-to-man sequence he uncovered could have resulted from the migration of the later appearing species from areas whose fossils were not yet known. Any suggestion that the pattern reflected the evolution or progressive creation of increasingly complex animals over time would be sheer speculation, he asserted. Overlapping with Cuvier's early and most original work on these matters, the English geologic cartographer William Smith found that he could definitively identify each stratum of sedimentary rock across Britain by the characteristic mix of the fossil species that it contained. Smith's findings reinforced and extended the concept of organic succession, but they too did not definitely demonstrate direction over time. Yet other naturalists soon made similar findings in fossil beds elsewhere, so that by the 1820s the conclusion became increasingly inescapable. New species both appeared and disappeared over time. There was simply no place where the newly appearing species could have migrated from. They must be truly new. With traditional faith in a single creation and the permanent endurance of species shattered, the search was on to discover more types of past life. Among the newfound fossil species, none attracted more attention than dinosaurs, particularly after their identification as gargantuan ancient reptiles. The fossil record appeared to show direction over time from a reptilian age to the present ascendancy of mammals. It was, in fact, Cuvier who identified the first known great reptile of a bygone era from a 4-foot fossil jawbone captured by the French Republican Army during its sweep of the Netherlands Meuse region in 1795. Known as Mosasaurus, or Lizard of Meuse, this was a huge reptile from secondary or Mesozoic chalk beds near Maastricht. These much-quarried ancient beds contained a rich array of fossil invertebrates, fish, and reptiles, but no mammals. Cuvier identified Mosasaurus as an extinct marine lizard with anatomic similarities to present-day monitor lizards of the tropics, but much bigger and solely aquatic. The honor of identifying the first great land lizards, later classified as dinosaurs, fell to an incongruous pair of English naturalists, William Buckland and Gideon Mantell. When Giants Walked in England. Buckland was a boisterous polymath of the early Victorian era. Ordained an Anglican cleric and elected a Fellow of Corpus Christi College, Oxford, in 1809, Buckland was tapped in 1818 for a new Oxford University readership in geology, a subject that he had loved since his childhood. He rose to the top of the British scientific establishment over the next 3 decades, serving twice as president of the Geological Society of London and once as president of the British Association for the Advancement of Science, all the while holding ecclesiastical posts ranging from a country rectory near Oxford to Dean of Westminster. Despite his prestigious positions, Buckland never took himself or his colleagues too seriously. His flamboyant lecturing style became legendary at Oxford. To illustrate his lectures on dinosaurs, for example, he might lumber around the lectern mimicking the gait of an overstuffed land lizard, or flap his clerical coattails like a winged pterodactyl. known for attributing the odd collection of prehistoric animal remains found in a Yorkshire cave to its supposed use in warmer pre-diluvial times as a hyena den, Buckland kept a live African hyena at his home, along with a pet bear, who accompanied the geologist to college functions wearing a cap and gown. Spoofing his reputation for discovering fossil reptiles, he served alligator meat to favored guests. As a young man, Charles Darwin found Buckland's antics off-putting and attributed them to a craving for notoriety, which sometimes made him act like a buffoon. But then Darwin went to Cambridge. An avid collector of specimens, Buckland obtained his first dinosaur fossils from a slate quarry near Oxford sometime during the late 1810s. The detached bones, he later wrote, must belong to several individuals of various ages and sizes. Whilst the vertebral column and extremities much resemble those of quadrupeds, the teeth show the creature to have been oviparous, and to have belonged to the order of saurians or lizards. Their size was striking. One thigh bone measured nearly 3 feet long and 10 inches around. If its relative proportions matched those of living lizards, then this animal had a length exceeding 40 feet and a bulk equal to that of an elephant 7 feet high, Buckland reported. It took some time for him to figure out what he had found, but it came from a secondary strata roughly the same age as the one that held Cuvier's Mosasaurus. And emboldened by that precedent, in 1824 Buckland finally published a description of his Megalosaurus, or great lizard, the largest land reptile heretofore identified. By the time that Buckland published his discovery, Gideon Mantell had found even grander fossil remains of the same species in southern England. The beast in question would have equaled in height our largest elephants, and in length fallen but little short of the largest whales, Buckland reported. Mantell practiced surgery for a living, but loved nothing more than to collect fossils, making his best finds in a sandstone quarry near his home in Sussex. His Megalosaurus fossils came from this site in 1821. Mantell's wife, Mary Ann, often accompanied her husband on his expeditions, until she became so tired of his morose, sometimes paranoid obsession with fossils, that she left him. She was along in 1822 when one of them found in exhumed rock an enormous fossil tooth, worn down like those of a plant-eating mammal. Yet mammal fossils did not come from this secondary strata. Even Cuvier was stymied by the tooth, at first identifying it as from a rhinoceros, and only later writing to Mantell, "Might we not have here a new animal, a herbivorous reptile?" Mantell confirmed Cuvier's suggestion by comparing the tooth with those of present-day iguanas, finding a match in everything except size. His tooth would have come from a 60-foot-long iguana, Mantell estimated. He published his find in 1825, making his iguanodon, or iguana tooth, the second dinosaur of record. Mantell identified a third species of dinosaur.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.